Hello, and welcome to our series, Lunch with Live in America. My name is Cynthia Post Hunt, and I'm the programmer for dance and theater at the Momentary. So today I'm here with Carra Martinez, our director for Live in America, and our friends from El Paso, Juárez, Edgar Picazo Merino and Amalia Mondragón. Today we are eating burritos.
Carra, hi, y'all. Welcome to Lunch with Live in America. I'm Carra Martinez, the director of Live in America. Live in America is a new performing arts festival, and the first iteration of that festival will be in October 21 at the Momentary in Bentonville. We're working with 8 communities from across the US, its territories, and a little into Mexico. And one of those communities is with us today, El Paso, Juárez. So I'm gonna let Edgar and Amalia introduce themselves now. We'll talk about burritos, we'll talk about art. We'll get into it. Go ahead, y'all.
Oh, okay.
Oh, Amalia.
Go ahead, Edgar. Go ahead.
Oh, cool. Hi, how are you guys? My name is Edgar Picazo. I'm here from the border, grew up in El Paso and Juárez. Super excited to be part of the Living America team this coming year. We've been working on what's gonna happen with our performance in Live America for a few months now. We decided to eat some burritos today. I think burritos really tell a lot about what life is like on the border. You know, it's like a very portable food. So we're always moving around, going from one place to another. I usually would prefer to have my grandma's burritos or my mom's burritos, but that's not possible right now. So I went to a store or a restaurant called El Jacalito, which is, I like their burritos. Yeah, they're really good. And I usually go around shopping different kind of burritos in different restaurants. Like there's some restaurants that have like good burritos of one kind and like one other restaurants, good burritos of another kind. So I got some bean and cheese burritos today. So, and of course, I don't know if I'm supposed to say brands or anything, but.
But you do it. People need to know the truth about this.
Yeah, Mexican cola. So it's like the border breakfast, a burrito and a Coke. So.
Malia.
Awesome. And then the Mexicano Cokes are supposed to be better because they're actually made with cane sugar and not high fructose corn syrup. So my name is Amalia Mondragón and I am calling right now from El Paso. I was born in East LA. I'm what you call an anchor baby. And I was raised in La Union, New Mexico, El Paso, Texas, and Ciudad Juárez, Chihuahua. Today my burrito is, I have two burritos. I got one that is chile relleno, which is a long green chile that's stuffed with cheese and I asked for beans, and then they kind of roll it in egg and then they fry it. And then I have a huevo a la mexicana, which is eggs, scrambled eggs with chile, tomato, and onion. And I got it from Lucy's Cafe. But my favorite burrito place is actually, I like this burrito de chile verde from the second ward area and the second ward in Segundo Barrio. It's really good.
I just want to point out that neither of you mentioned rice on your burrito.
Oh, no rice.
Yeah. Less people be confused about different kinds of burrito cultures.
You can add beans to any kind of, how do you say guisado in English? Stew?
Stew, yeah.
So like any burrito has beans in it, but no rice.
No rice. Or aguacate, you can, if you have money, because it gets expensive. And the point of burritos is that they're supposed to be cheap and on the go.
I just want a chili relleno, man.
I'm gonna send you one.
Oh my god!
I'm gonna FedEx it.
Yes. Don't speak my dreams aloud on camera. I'm gonna hold you accountable.
You know, people, what? I'm sorry, last talk of food, but here in El Paso, there's this flauta place that's, I don't like it, but it's like a thing. And there's well, they're not really flautas. They're like rolled tacos. They call them rolled tacos and they're called chicos tacos. And they come in a little bowl and they soak them with this like tomato juice thing. And when you're drunk, it's really good. But they say that, you know, chicos tacos is rented because as soon as it goes in, it comes out, you know, in various forms. But people, like, they love chicos tacos. And when people move, like, they actually have chicos tacos frozen and FedEx to them. People do that. So, yeah, it's pretty interesting.
But it's like a flauta with a tomato sauce.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And government yellow cheese.
I can see it. High fat content.
Yeah. And the best experience is like watching the different types of people. I mean, I've never seen so many Elvis impersonators when Elvis impersonators don't really exist anymore in a line with like all kinds of different, you know, rhinestone cowboy boots and different types of people. Like it's a great Jerry Springer show to go into. You see all kinds of stuff.
What I love about what's happening, like number one, it just makes me want to eat so much food. So that's good. But also it like starts to get to this like first question of like, what are the pathways and the gestures and the foods and the rules and regulations that determine an idea like America? So the question that we always begin with is, what does America mean to you, to y'all? And we just let that go wherever it goes. So that's the first question here. Like, what does America, that idea, mean to y'all?
Who wants to begin? You want to go, Amalia, or you want?
I guess, I guess when I think of America, I think of continents. And I think of vast amounts of people and different cultures and languages and dialects and colors. Like, I guess it means diversity to me.
Yeah, it's a little weird because I feel like crossing back and forth on the border, I've learned to really think about, like, you know, the term, like the actual term American. Mm-hmm. And since we come from like a Hispanic or Latin background, you know, we or at least I grew up with this idea that, you know, like America is not just the US, you know, like America is like, you know, the whole continent. So I learned to make that distinction, I guess. So like for me, when somebody says American, I mean, it could be anyone from the whole continent. In fact, like when I cross the bridge and I tell them what my city, what where I'm from, I tell them I'm a US of A citizen, you know, and I don't say American like I used to before back in the day. So I'm a little bit careful about like the terms that I use when I describe myself, but also like if you say you're a US citizen, you could be like a US citizen from Mexico, because Mexico is its legal name in the United States of Mexico. So it's but if we're talking about what it means to be from like the United States of America, you know, like being from here, I don't know, it really means that you're like in the middle of everything. You're not, it sounds like a little bit centric in a way, but we're part of this like huge combination of people and ideas and like backgrounds and stuff. And it just It's very interesting. Yeah, it's very interesting, especially with like what's been happening in the past few years. Like it, to be in this space and to really, I mean, consider where we're from. And I don't know, it's just, it makes me feel like I have some kind of responsibility of how I, of what I do. I don't know. It's really weird. I don't know if I'm making sense.
Like responsibility, how?
Responsibility of being, in a way, I feel like everybody's watching us right now, you know, and everybody's paying attention to what's going on here. And it's something that's been happening, like, I mean, on the border for like a long time, but then like, also like, in general right now, everybody's just like, the whole world has their eyes on us. And there's this like, narrative that's coming out that in a way, I feel responsible for like providing a different narrative and providing a different way of people understanding who we are, especially right now, you know, like maybe like 10 years ago, I didn't really care about it, but now the way things are, I feel like I have to be a little bit extra careful with the things that are coming out of here, no? Like what are we producing? Like what messages are we giving out? What, like, you know, what truths we're like talking about and stuff. So that's, yeah.
I think you're sort of naming for me, that's why we begin with this question, because it's such a loaded term, politically, culturally, all of us socioeconomically, that we have to wrangle with it right now. We're like literally responsible for wrangling with it ourselves and sitting with it and framing it and reframing it. I mean, as part of our work as artists as well. Like, what does it mean to say that we're artists from America, and like what baggage does that come with if we take up that label, and what responsibilities as well?
Yeah, I feel, you know, when you mentioned the word responsible, it made me think of, it's so interesting how everybody has a different, well, when you choose to take responsibility, everybody has a different reason to be a different reason for being responsible. And I feel like my reason for being responsible as a border citizen, as a fronterizix, is that I feel like, well, not everybody has the chance to cross, to be a transient border crosser. And I almost feel, I'm not saying everybody's like this, but I feel like a lot of people that I talk to who are from the border feel this some kind of guilt for having the privilege to cross, knowing that you have family members who cannot cross, who cannot, who don't have the same privileges that some of us might have, even though we don't have as much privilege as maybe other people would. Like just that tiny bit of privilege that we do have, I feel like a responsibility to be like a carrier of messages, of information to both sides of the border, and to create, you know, this to create community on both sides, and or not create it, but to form part of community on both sides. And, you know, I feel like it's been a really, I mean, I feel like my whole life I felt that way. And it feels so almost surreal that there's attention being brought to this area, because we've been ignored for so long. And I feel like the times that we haven't been ignored, you know, people come by who are not from here and then stamp these, like, you know, I feel like they try to stamp these stickers on our mouths of what the border's like. And, you know, I think, Edgar, I think you're doing great. You know, I think we're all doing great at just being ourselves. And I think it is important to be extra careful about how we express ourselves or what we say so that people can understand the translation of what we're trying to say, because a lot of times, you know, people don't really grasp the, it's such a living in the border is constant code switching. We were talking about code switching earlier, and it's, you know, in order for code switching to be successful, you really have to understand both languages, and then you have to find a way to even translate that language to everybody else. And so it's interesting because we have such a combination of all kinds of things going on here, especially being so underrepresented by both sides of the border. Both central powers just don't really represent the border too well, which is kind of still, even though there's a camera shining on us right now, we're still very underrepresented and underheard. I know that I've just went down a completely different path, but I feel like, I don't know, that's what the word responsibility triggered in me. It was.
Yeah, it all comes down to being an American. And I feel like, I mean, now that you mentioned, like, after hearing you talk, like being an American on a border town is like we have access to both cultures and it's always like this question of like what is the ethical way of like doing that? Like the other day I was talking to a friend about the fact that, for example, like rents are like super high along the Juárez side of the border because there's people that earn dollars and move to Juárez, and so like now you're this American that's like, you know, like going to Juárez and just like raising the rents of people there. So you have to, you know, there's like all these different dynamics that happen here that even though like we're Mexican Americans and we like feel like we do belong in both sides of the border, like we still have like, you know, that like you were talking about stamps, we have that stamp of like, oh, you're an American and you're just like, you know, making things maybe harder for us right now. So it's like, it's always like finding like a balance or a middle ground of not being like just being ethical about like all the decisions that we make, like living on the border, I guess, you know, it's a little difficult sometimes.
Yeah, there's so many little things. I mean, even like, there's just like, unspoken rules, like when you cross the border and you're crossing with somebody who's a resident and can't go through the citizen line, which is usually faster, like there's no question, you obviously wait in the long line with the person, and you know, and it's so interesting how there's guilt involved and there's shame and there's all this, there's so much involved in and these are just little things, you know, they're little things, but they're enormous. Also, it's so interesting and dynamic. The slight changes in privilege and opportunities yeah, it's just a really, and they're so minute, but we see them all here. And so I'm sorry, go ahead.
But so for when y'all are like thinking about working with artists, like how does that, like the things that you're naming, of course, don't like suddenly disappear when you start collaborating across the border. So when you're thinking about making like trans-border art and collaborating, how does that work? How do you do it? What are you holding? I mean, you're getting at some of it, but even just thinking through art making processes having to be incredibly different.
Well, I guess, well, I mean, first of all, not every artist works on both sides of the border. Not every artist in the US here in El Paso works on both sides of the border. But when you do work on both sides of the border, you get to know a lot of artists on both sides. And first of all, there's so many amazing artists in Juárez, amazing. And there's amazing artists in El Paso as well. But sometimes I feel like in Juárez, there's just, it's a little more, it's just a lot more natural, like this very, it's just very honest. Like just, it just, there's just some honesty and rawness to the beauty and the art in Juárez. So usually I'm always thinking, well, how can I help provide money or opportunities, or how can I create a metaphorical bridge for artists to get to know each other on both sides and help each other, you know, like give opportunities for money on both sides, or opportunities to learn from each other, to connect, to create communication. And so I always have artists in mind from Juárez and from El Paso. It's kind of like that code switching. So when it comes to certain projects, you're not really thinking, it's interesting because you don't really think like, well, you know, you just kind of think in code switch. So it's almost seamless. So when you think of a project, you think of the colors that would make up that project, and those colors they're like people are, I don't know, to me, I kind of think of people as colors. And so then I just create, like, it's like a canvas is the opportunity. The opportunity is the canvas. And then people are colors, and you can just create this beautiful art piece with a collaborative pieces from both sides. So you just call them and you just let them know, dude, there's this great opportunity, and this is my idea. This is the idea. This is what we're looking for. What do you think? And some people are interested and some people are not. That's been my experience. And it's just really being involved on both sides so that you know who is existent and who does what and how they do it.
Yeah, I feel like you have to, first of all, understand the limitations of the people that you're working with, right? I mean, if you decide to start working on a project that will be successful on both sides of the border, you have to, first of all, take into consideration the limitations that there will be from both parts, right? And I feel like this is like a conversation that's been going on for a while, and a conversation that's actually, like, right before the pandemic started, there, I feel like, had started to be like a bigger kind of like transactional process between El Paso and Juárez. But I remember going to, like, for example, like Juárez openings, art openings, and people were surprised that, you know, we were going from El Paso, and because, yeah, you know, like, there's this like, like this connection between the artistic scenes on both sides. And I feel like that was like starting, or that is starting to change. And there's like, you know, like there's some of us that not only like have US and Mexican citizenship, but we also know both languages. We're able to, like, you know, like move around in both cities without a problem. So I feel like there's like a few of us that are able to easily talk to people and understand, like, not only their, like, language, but, like, you know, like where they come from. It's up to us to, like, kind of like start creating these bridges between both sides, you know. But I feel like the first thing that, like I said before, is like understanding what the limitations are and working from there. Because if you try to do something that's not possible, it's just going to be like extremely frustrating for people on both sides. And that's where, you know, people get mad, or they get resentful, or they end up like not wanting to work on the other side again, because they don't understand what the limits are of these kind of collaborations.
Right. What I love about what you're saying too, I mean, this is like, as we begin talking about this project, is I think that there's this idea that it's, you know, art just like comes to you and you're just going to brainstorm and you just go be creative. But the reality is, in so many spaces, that you have to think through resources, and that careful analysis of resources actually what gets you to a successful project. That it's not like, we're just going to brainstorm and figure it out. I mean, I'm like, that smacks of, you got a lot of privilege. But that resource analysis is super, super important when going through these processes, and being really transparent about it, and transparent as you can possibly be about budgets, and that in fact, that empowers people. It's not like, because they understand like the situational dynamics. It's not like limiting them, it's helping them understand how to code switch and move and do all the things that y'all have been naming.
Yeah, I'm glad Edgar touched on that. I feel like I've been doing this for so long that to me, like the whole resource thing is just already calculated in there. Like, I already know who is an amazing artist that I can work with and what the conversation is. And that's a great point. I feel like maybe I'm speaking like taking certain steps for granted, no? Like that are already just built in there.
I don't think you're taking them for granted. I think you're like ahead of the game. I think we were talking on these talks, we have long conversations before we begin. But we were talking about, about like high art speak. And sometimes like, I want to just talk about money and that feels so gauche, but I'm like, no, money is like mission and vision. And like how, like, I don't want to feel embarrassed that's where like my brain starts oftentimes, is like, is with resources and responsibility. Like oftentimes that's where I begin with on any project. Who we need to be responsible and take care of, and what are our resources? And the other stuff is like easier to figure out. There's my dog. Oh man. Cynthia, anything that like pinging for you in all this?
I'm just thinking a lot about what I'm hearing, what everyone's saying. I'm just thinking, I mean, how intentional all of these decisions are, and thinking about resources, thinking about like the work that both of you do in that collaborative space. Like, being collaborative is an intentional decision and is an intentional practice, but you're like crossing the border, right? Like, there are all these extra layers of that intentionality that I just think is, it speaks to the project of the whole festival. I think, as Kara was saying, we're, you know, on every level, on every decision, every conversation, there's so many layers of intentionality. But I think that's what makes a successful collaboration, right? It's like when you recognize your resources and recognize the power dynamics, the money, all of that, and then the transparency. I think it's just the intentionality of the work is really resonating with me right now.
It made me think of you know, a while ago when, gosh, like, it's just, you really have to really think things through when you're going to work internationally. Like, I remember many times having to cross drums, entire drum sets and instruments. Like, it's like, well, we're gonna have a gig this weekend. You can't cross with your instrument because then you will be deported. You will be flagged for working on this side. So it's like, you know, taking an entire drum set and then going through the checkpoint, and they're like, you're not a drummer. And you're like, how do you know? You don't know that. Why? Because I'm a girl. So you gotta fight. And then you gotta, and then you gotta go through the machine because they think you're dealing drugs. And then you gotta go back and pick up somebody else's bass. You gotta go 3 or 4 times to pick up all the instruments, or someone else who has a US citizenship has to come in with all these instruments. And this is just for a gig, you know? And so these are things that you learn early on. And then later on, I guess you just become like, well, okay, I know if I'm gonna hire this person, or if I'm gonna be working with this person, then this is gonna be involved. Like a lot of times you gotta go and pick up their art supplies and bring it over, or purchase art supplies here, and they could take it back. They just can't bring it in. And so it's just been, yeah, it's definitely calculating the resources and the steps that are gonna have to be taken, extra steps that are gonna have to be taken to create these spaces of collaboration.
We're almost out of time for lunch. I mean, what I love about, we'll do this again, but talk specifically about your project, El Puente, but that's what it's surfacing, that it's not only that project is aimed at like surfacing that movement and the thinking and the care and the sounds and the stories of what it means to like live in that go between and move inside that between space. And now I just got really excited for it. Like listening to the two of you, I was like, oh man, I'm so ready to see what this thing is gonna be. And to like learn from it. Like that's the thing I've taken from today and just this short conversation is there y'all have so many skills and insights and like are wired to read space in such complex and nuanced ways. And then in fact, we would all be better off if we had some border mentality and that border way of thinking, that we would maybe take better care of one another if we had those practices. But thanks for being here with us today. On that note, we did not plan the color coordination that has happened, but when you started talking about like color and painting people with colors, I was like, well, we painted ourselves today.
We did.
But thank y'all so much for being at lunch with us.
Thank you.
Thank you for the invitation.